So this morning, our next speaker is Michael Finnegan, the CEO and Managing Director of Macmahon Holdings. Good morning, Michael. How are you?
Hi, Geary. Great. Look, good morning, everyone, and thanks for your time today. And it's a pleasure to be here to present to you. My name's Mick Finnegan. I'm a mining engineer, and I followed my dad's footsteps into the mining industry. I've been lucky enough to work on both the east and west coast of Australia, as well as a number of countries in Asia. And I started with Macmahon in 2014. I became the CEO in late 2016, and then late last year was appointed the MD. And today, I really want to talk to you about the company history and really zero in on the last 3 years. We think that's quite important. Obviously, as Steve did, I want to talk about how we've dealt with COVID. And then I'll round it out and just touch on our vision and strategy and why we're excited by the opportunities in front of us. And I'll start with the overview on the next slide. Macmahon is a leading mining services company, and it's been around for over 50 years. And clearly we've had many strong learnings over that time and evolved significantly as a business. And especially since early 2017, which I personally see as a starting point for the current management team. We now offer an end-to-end suite of services to our clients that includes engineering, maintenance, early civil earthworks, open pit and underground mining solutions, and of course some rehabilitation options. And we have a workforce of over 7,000 people and operate and maintain a fleet which includes over 500 pieces of major equipment. On the next slide, I've included a map of where we operate. And as you can see, we have a strong presence in Australia, primarily in WA and Queensland at the moment, and Southeast Asia, in particular Indonesia, where we have been operating for over 10 years. And just as a bit of a snapshot, you'll see on the slide, and I want to call it out, that you know over 60% of our revenue is currently generated in Australia, and over 80% of our revenue is exposed to gold and copper gold operations, which I think is pretty important given the current climate. Now, as I said a moment ago, I think the turning point for us was about early 2017, and you can see the growth since then in the next slide. Since that time, we've achieved significant growth in revenue and earnings and have consistently been in line with our guidance, which was a key for the new management team as we wanted to obviously build credibility. And this has put us in the fortunate position we're in today. And at the start of 2017, we thankfully had in place a really strong, newly established vision. We had a strong team. We had really supportive existing clients. And also on the horizon, we had a number of well-progressed new opportunities with some really strategic clients. And that was important because it did allow us to defend an opportunistic takeover attempt made by CIMIC at 14.5 cents, which we felt at the time significantly undervalued the company. And obviously the proof's been in the pudding since then. A key pivotal moment at that time was the award of the Batu Hijau contract for us. And that allowed us to not only partner with a strategic client, but also gain a very supportive, significant shareholder. Batu Hijau is a world-class copper-gold asset. It operates in the bottom quartile of the global cost curve, and it's an alliance-style contract for us that's performed exceptionally well since it started nearly 3 years ago. Around the same time that we were awarded the Batu Hijau contract, Byerwen Coking Coal Project, we're awarded the Byerwen Coking Coal Project with QCoal. Now, this was another alliance where we're seen and treated as a real partner. It's an exciting coking coal, long life asset and one of the lowest cost producers in the Bowen Basin. And this project also has performed incredibly well since we started and gave us great pleasure to be able to announce a couple of weeks ago the $700 million extension and expansion of this contract. And we feel really reflected the relationship we have on site there. Also, towards the end of 2017, we were awarded the surface contract at Dacian's Mount Morgans Gold Project in WA. So as you'll see on the slide, in a relatively short period of time, the company grew from $360 million of revenue a year to over where we sit now, over $1.3 billion of revenue a year. And this meant that as a new management team, we'd achieved our first real strategic priority, which was to achieve scale, and it increased the profit margins, obviously. The other important part of achieving that first strategic priority was it opened the gate for us to move to the second, which was to broaden our service offering. And there was a specific focus at the time on the civil and underground opportunities in front of us. And Obviously, with the dynamic team we have in place, they didn't waste any time making that happen. And in 2018, we acquired a small Queensland-based civil business called TMM. And this not only built up our civil capability, but also helped us anchor our presence in Queensland, which was incredibly important at that time. Then in 2019, we turned our attention towards growing the underground business. And since then, we've been awarded the underground Boston Shaker contract at Tropicana, where we operate the pits. We completed an acquisition of the GBF Group in August, and in February, they extended their Silver Lake Resources contract near Kalgoorlie. And all of this culminated in the underground business growing from about $80 million a year 15 months ago to about $300 million a year revenue now in a relatively short period of time. And it's got us well on our way to our initial target of growing that part of the business to $500 million a year. Clearly for us, we identified that having the capability to do both surface and underground is complementary, and it's obviously a key competitive advantage for us. So overall, I hope the takeaway you can get from this slide is that the new management team have managed to continually execute and progress on our strategic goals to develop the company while always achieving our publicly stated guidance. So before I start to talk about our future aspirations, I want to quickly talk about how we've dealt with COVID on the next slide. Like many companies, we've employed various measures to preserve cash, protect our strong balance sheet, and most importantly, of course, for us to focus on the health and safety of our people. And the controls have been different in different jurisdictions, and they're summarised here on this slide. And if you want more detail, it is available on our website. But overall, it's great to see that the protocols put in place have largely worked, and it's a credit to all the people involved, to the industry and all the bodies that have supported it. And as many of you may know, in Australia, mining was classed as an essential industry, and this has been incredibly helpful. And as a result, the demand for our services has remained strong. In Indonesia, though, there is a slightly different risk profile, but rest assured, our client there has the strictest controls in place. And in fact, at Batu Hijau, which is our largest contract, we see the most stringent controls that we have implemented across our entire business. And this clearly is a credit to not only the senior management on site, but also to our client AMNT. And to give you a bit of an idea, the site, which is already remotely located on Sumbawa Island, has since early March also had its perimeter locked down. The client and the teams on site introduced extended rosters and hired out hotels on a nearby island near the airport to quarantine people prior to entering site after they've been on their rotation off. Testing is conducted twice a week, both during quarantine and the working cycles. Masks are compulsory. Social distancing that we're familiar with in Australia is exhibited on site, and the infrastructure on site has also been upgraded to get a hospital that has 160 beds, of which 40 beds are ICU beds equipped fully with ventilators. So in summary, I can say that while the team has clearly had to extend itself to manage the risks of COVID, there's been no material impact on our earnings guidance for financial year 20. And while we can't get complacent, clearly, my confidence of maintaining that continuity is growing beyond that point. So given this increased confidence in the controls of COVID for us, we are now starting to cautiously redirect some of the team's focus back to our stated strategy, and I'll talk to that now on the next slide. And I'm not going to go through all the details that are on here, but I want to talk to a couple of key points. And for us, first and foremost, now we've established a reliable, almost steady state delivering business foundation. We have a laser-like focus on optimising that business and enhancing our margins. Secondly, as I mentioned earlier, we're still working through expanding our service offering, and that still includes civil and underground, but also some rehabilitation business and opportunities. And we do intend to grow our civil business from its Queensland base into WA, New South Wales, and potentially even Indonesia. The underground business, which is well placed to reach its initial goal of $500 million a year revenue, we feel has opportunities to grow beyond that in time. And in the rehabilitation sector, we do see significant potential, and there's a number of opportunities we see coming up over the next few years. So if you think about it, if with the end-to-end suite of services in place and the base business performing reasonably well, we now think we're well equipped to tackle the third focus area, which is organically securing our fair share of new work opportunities that's in our pipeline, and I'll discuss that in a few slides. And then the fourth piece for us is, you know, obviously we want to expand our offering, but we also want to modernise it. And that's a key for us, because for us, it will ensure our relevance in the contracting industry in the future. And I'd like to talk about that now on the next slide. So 3 years ago, our team started developing our vision of how we saw Macmahon as a participant of the mining services industry of the future. And we believe the ability to sustainably achieve tech-enabled efficiency gains will differentiate us and be a key competitive advantage. We recognise that to do this, we clearly needed a strong digital backbone in place, and we commenced that then, and we're well along that journey now. And we've also been an early adopter by investing in our IoT platform, which has helped us identify site-specific opportunities for improvement. And while that's great, the real prize for us will be once we've taken the next step and developed a platform to connect all our people, equipment, processes and plans together in a single digital nervous system. This system will enable us to identify inefficiencies in real time and implement solutions quickly to add value to both ourselves and our clients. As I said, I'm not going to go through all the detail, but just as an example, picture this. Maybe a person starts their shift. They sign in by either thumbprint or facial recognition. Their arrival signals to the supervisor for the allocation of their tasks for the day and to payroll. The supervisor allocates a team member for that day's tasks, and then the system will confirm that they're appropriately trained and competent to do those duties. The system will log the individual's performance during the shift, and any areas for improvement are recorded for the next training session. So the next training session is not just a generic training session. Also during the shift, smart algorithms monitor the performance of not only the operator, but also the fleet and the team, and it logs all those productive and non-productive waste items for review on an hourly, shift, daily, weekly and monthly basis. This data is then continually reviewed for improvement opportunities and compliance to plan. And clearly there's much more to our vision than this, but I hope that does give you a sense, a flavour of what we're aspiring to. Now, of course, this vision and what we've achieved in recent times could not have happened without our amazing team of over 7,000 men and women, and I'll touch on that now in the next slide. In fact, what has been evident through the COVID period, to be honest, is that our team has pulled together incredibly well, and they're probably far more resilient and capable than we sometimes appreciate. But the leaders have been outstanding, and the can-do agile culture that we've been trying to build over the years has been really visible. Also, on the slide you'll see, I know our safety is spoken about extensively in our industry, but I must say I'm proud about how the Macmahon team has put this in action. And you can see on that slide how our injury rates have continued to improve even while our employee numbers have substantially increased, which is really pleasing. Also pleasing, and something I'm really proud of, is our mental health program, Strong Minds, Strong Minds. And you can see on the top right hand corner of the slide there, it's led by the relatable figurehead, Soa Palele. Now, he's overcome his own personal challenges and is well equipped to lead this for us. He's an interesting guy. He was an ex-UFC heavyweight fighter. He was even Leonardo DiCaprio's personal trainer, actually. But it's his ability to connect with people that makes a big difference and relay his story and his experiences. Now, this award-winning program is being recognised more broadly through the industry, but what's more important to us is seeing the impact, positive impacts, this is having on our people and our families. And make no mistake, there's absolutely a return on investment to the company by doing this, by having happy and healthy people. Now we'll turn to the next slide and have a look at our financial health quickly. And I think it's important here to highlight our strong balance sheet, which has been critical as we've navigated through recent uncertainty. However, probably more important for me is if this is managed correctly, it really will be one of the catalysts for us to secure some of the transformational opportunities in front of us. And I'm not going to bombard you with numbers here, but I'd like to highlight on that slide that you can see our gearing was low at 19%. We expect that to strengthen by June. And we've had healthy returns on capital and return on equity. And I would like to point out that about 12 months ago, we restarted paying sustainable dividends. So this strong balance sheet positions us well to execute on our secured work, which I'll discuss now in the next spot. Our significant order book affords us with excellent medium-term visibility, as hopefully you can see, and it's a solid platform for us to continue to grow earnings. And I feel this really differentiates us from our peers, especially the fact that it's not a spike and falls away quickly. It's quite consistent. The order book is made up of clearly some amazing clients with some great assets, and it includes a number of strategic alliances, which are very important to us because it means we can flexibly work with our clients to find win-win outcomes, especially when situations change, which is normally the highest risk situation for a contractor. I think I'll call out again here, as you can see, that 80% of our earnings is exposed to gold and copper gold, and the majority of the revenue from our clients comes from mines that sit in the bottom half of the global cost curve. So on top of this order book, we have a significant tender pipeline, which will add additional earnings to what you can see here. And I'll talk to that on the next slide. So this slide depicts a tender pipeline in bubbles. It currently sits at around $7 billion of credible opportunities. $2 to $4 billion of these opportunities could be potentially awarded over the next 12 months. And a lot of this potential work is with current clients. And I think it's very important to call out, and we've put it up on the slide there by naming them. Over the next 12 months, we should expect an increase in contract scopes at both Tropicana and Batu-Hijau, and on those projects we have life of mine contracts. They're both well advanced in investigations on options to extend their mine life, which we're very excited about. So clearly, with our secured work from the previous slide performing well, and the pipeline that we've just touched on here, we're well positioned to continue to grow if we just keep doing the right thing and don't get ahead of ourselves. So now turning to the final slide. In summary, we feel our outlook is very positive, and we're delighted today to reaffirm our financial year 20 guidance, which we did upgrade in February this year. We have built what we feel is a leading mining services business, which levers off our flexible alliance approach and our ability to service the whole mining chain. We have a strong team, balance sheet, clients, order book and tender pipeline. And just as importantly, we have a clear vision of what a contractor of the future looks like, and we think how to get there. And whilst we are well positioned, I'm really pleased the team is remaining humble. They clearly recognise that we're only in the early stages of resetting the company, and there's still much more improvement for us to realise as we're building something special if we stay focused. So overall, everyone, I'm confident we can continue on our successful trajectory and deliver strong earnings growth for the foreseeable future.